Hello, everyone. This is Chris Hewerts coming to you live from Little Gravity Center here in Omaha, Nebraska, and I hope everybody's having a great Wednesday. Wanted to welcome you to our Monday wellness webinar, and today is going to be remarkable. We have Marion Gilbert joining us from Nevada City, California, and if you've not ever interacted with her before, I think you're going to find this not only encouraging, but there's a kind of soothing, fierce strength that she brings that I think will help ground and center us all. I know that it's day whatever for many of us in our quarantines or our shelter in place, and realizing that every 12 hours, it seems like the news changes from better to worse, back to hopeful. And yesterday, Flynn and I took Sweet Puppy Basil on a walk in one of the parks here in the city, and she asked me how I was doing, and I don't always actually sort of stop and consciously reflect on these things, but it hit me pretty hard when she asked me, and I sort of had this thought that I feel like we're in this kind of experience of exhaustion, but there's a kind of it's not exactly tired, and it's not exactly tired and the kind of tired that we suffer from overdoing things, or it's not the kind of lethargy that sets in at the end of a vacation. I think it's a kind of weariness. I think it's a kind of exhaustion. And I think this is becoming a lot of our experience. I think it's because we don't know how to be right now, because we're making all of these changes that we weren't prepared to make. And I think part of this is also because we are experiencing a kind of fatigue based on the unknown. We don't know how much longer we're going to have to live like this. We don't know how much longer we're going to have to be concerned and careful like this. And so what I hope that some of you can experience today in this conversation with Marion is just a little bit of a break from that, a little bit of peace of mind and peace of heart and kind of a relaxing and a centering into your body. So before we get started, I want to thank you all for joining us, and wanted to sort of put this out there to sort of see or let you all see where everybody's coming from. And so if you're not on this sort of map here, holler at us, because it sure would be great if we knew where you were. But it looks like we have folks from almost 40 states, from Australia, Canada, Denmark, India, South Africa, Sweden, and the UK signing in. I'm not sure how this works on Zoom, but you know, in the old days, like when you would have a Facebook invite and you'd get like 327 people to say they're coming, and then 17 actually showed up. It looks like we had almost 200 people register for this today. And as we've mentioned before, if you are unable to make these live, they're always going to be replayed. And so we'll save these and post these online. And then the show notes and the follow-up email that we send afterwards we'll get those to you. So I'm going to turn over to Felina, but thank you all for joining us. It's great to have you all here. It feels like we're in this together and that we're connected when we meet like this.
So hello there, everyone. I'm really glad that you've joined us today. You are in for a treat. If there's any webinar you do not want to miss, it's this one. I cannot wait to introduce you to Marion. Before I do that, I want to invite us to come into the present moment a little bit more here. And so as we're settling in and finding our place, let me just invite you to find your seat, to bring yourself into your seat. So just allowing your attention to find the chair beneath you and noticing the earth beneath the chair supporting you. And let's take a few deep breaths as a way of transitioning now from getting here to being here. So inhaling fully from the base of the belly, letting the breath travel all the way up through the torso, through the chest, the neck, the head, and exhaling completely. Inhaling again deeply from the belly, through the belly, chest, and head, exhaling completely, letting all that stale air out on, on the bottom of the breath. Again, inhale deeply here. And exhale completely. And then we can let that breath return to its normal function. Just noticing now the effortless effort of the body breathing itself. Notice the breath as it goes in and down on the in-breath. And up and out on the out breath. Just letting yourself settle here into the breath, that automatic rhythmic breath. Just see if you can notice it without having to do anything about it, without bringing any control to the breath, just witnessing it. Now bring your attention to the mind and notice thoughts that may be drifting by or perhaps capturing your attention. See if you can get a little distance from your thoughts so that you can observe them and notice how they come and go. Now bring your attention to the heart space. See if you can notice here any emotions that might be surfacing or perhaps lingering under the surface. Again, just getting a little distance from your emotions so that you can observe them. Notice here also how your emotions come and go. And now see if you can drop down into your belly center, bringing your attention to the body. Noticing sensations on the inside of the body, as well as on the surface of the body. See if you can pay attention and observe sensations in the body. Notice too that sensations come and go. Make any adjustments in your seat so that your body can be more supportive, allowing it to relax a little bit more. Just taking a moment to cultivate that interior solitude, silence, and stillness. See if you can notice that here for a moment. Now that we are a little bit more present, finding ourselves a little bit more connected to one another, I want to read to you a poem, a very brief poem by Morgan Harper Nichols, who will be our guest on Friday during Kids Contemplation. This is from her new book titled, All Along You Were Blooming. Even in your uncertainty and even in your waiting, you have made it this far, and that is worth celebrating. So I would love to introduce you now to our guest, Marion Gilbert. Marion has been practicing physical therapy for 42 years, and she's the owner of a well-established physical therapy practice and movement studio in Grass Valley, California. She has extensive training in cranial sacral therapy, So motto, emotional release, and trauma resolution. Marion has been actively using the Enneagram professionally and personally for the past 17 years. She emphasizes understanding the role of the somatic lens of perception in facilitation of personal and spiritual transformation in the Enneagram. Her specific interest is in developing somatic awareness for reconciling three-centered awareness in relationship to contemplation and awakening. Marion developed the Somatic Enneagram Certification Training and is teaching locally and internationally. She's an adjunct faculty member of the Narrative Enneagram and an advisory board member of the Enneagram Prison Project. I met Marion only a year ago this month. Yeah, I was just realizing it. Yeah, like I think it's a year ago next week.
Yeah.
And I feel like I've known her for a lifetime because we've gone very deep together.
Exactly.
She has supported me in going to the depths of my own soul and psyche. And it's been incredible to know her and to be in her presence. And I am just so joy-filled that we could provide this space for all of you to be able to sit with Marion today. This is seriously a privilege of a lifetime. And so without taking up any more of Marion's time, I'd like to turn it over to Marion to be with us in this crucial moment in time that we're all facing with COVID-19 and the crisis it's created for us.
Thank you so much, Felina and Chris, for doing the work that you guys are doing. And, you know, your center's name to me says it all. You know, there is a certain amount of palpable gravity in everything that's happening right now. It is where we're all being taken very deeply down onto this earth and we having to feel and sense, you know, the impact of what we are being, you know, required to do all together. And the beauty of all of this, that it's pretty well globally happening. So it is an amazing opportunity for all of us to know that we are literally in it together, that there isn't so much anybody who's more privileged than another person, that we all have to, you know, go back to the basics of what life is really all about and what is driving our human behaviors in a time like this is my biggest question for myself. And it's amazing to watch for me. And I know that a large portion of you are familiar with the Enneagram, but maybe also a portion of you aren't. So I'm gonna pretty much give this talk from the greater perspective of the three-centered awareness. And that's an important piece to know about because this actually is now also being verified by neuroscience, as well as that it was really known by the ancient traditions, the spiritual traditions, that it wasn't so easy to, you know, go home to God and be with God, or to go home and be fully awakened and enlightened in our being, or to become fully knowledgeable of the greater knowing that includes the not knowing. You know, all that is really being known, that it isn't an easy road to begin with. But at this time, I believe there is a great opportunity for all of us to learn how to become inquisitive and to do a piece of inquiry in what is really happening on the inside as we are experiencing the outside laying some big demands on us that we are definitely not used to, and that is not so easy to answer to. And I'd like to explore that with all of you. And the format that I would like to use is that I will do a piece of of teaching, and then I'll ask Felina to come in, and then if there are any questions, we can spend a little bit of time just answering some questions that may come up in your chat box that you could actually pose. And Felina is going to track all of those, and she's going to pick out some questions. And my apologies for the questions that we cannot, you know, answer because of the volume of the questions, as you can imagine. Right now I see on my screen there is about 125 people that are logged in. So welcome to all of you from all over the world. And thank you for taking this time, you know, to dive a little bit deeper into what is really going on the inside of you in reaction to the outside creating quite a bit of suffering. And the suffering that is being experienced has to do with the big word here in the United States is social distancing. You know, it used to be called social isolation, and then they changed the word to it not being so strongly really saying what it actually is, because it is about isolation, right? What is social distancing doing to us? How is it impacting us? And what happens in reaction to it that is largely probably not known, or it may not be known by you what actually occurs? So to me, social distancing is a very instinctually challenging thing to practice. And if you go out to the grocery store and you see how few people are wired, you know, to keep these distances between yourself and another, when you stand across from each other 6 feet in between and have a conversation with somebody that you normally would go up to and touch or hug or, you know, acknowledge in more of a physical way. So the lack of touch right now and the lack of contact hits us in the emotional center in our hearts. And it's very, very important, you know, to understand that, you know, this intimacy that we naturally get from being touched briefly or having close proximity to, or having somebody just put a hand on your knee or on your back, all these things is a language that we normally, you know, get that provides nourishment for the heart center, the emotional center of our being. And this is not happening right now. And even though it's wonderful that we can talk through the screens, it is not really going to ever replace that amount of nourishment. So based on that, you know, we're all kind of walking around with a little bit of the grief at the loss of contact. You know, that's deeper sadness and the desire, you know, to really not obey your rules and just to go up and say, okay, well, I just need to give you a hug right now. And to know that it may not be, you know, the right thing to do. And to have understanding that you're a human being that is hardwired for that touch and for that amount of nourishment that we get when we are with each other. If you look at the clans in the past, in the prehistoric times, all the way through now, that we are, you know, gathered around fires and gathered in dance and in circle activities, and as well as one-to-one relating and healing traditions, you know, that use touch and that use a certain amount of close proximity in order to transmit a healing energy for the other. You know, that doesn't mean it is limited by that, but that is a large portion of how this is being translated, that is not occurring right now. And I just want to stand still for a minute with that and just see if each one of you on the call can just close your eyes for a minute and just see if you can turn your attention inside of yourself. And as you notice when the attention goes inside, and you notice the breath going up through your nostrils when you breathe in, going up to the bottom center of your brain in your head, and then it turns on its own, and it drops downward through your neck and your throat into your chest cavity, where your heart and your lungs are, and where your emotional center is. That's the place where we receive the other and where we give to the other energetically through transmission. And as our arms are conveniently located as extension of this center through reaching for the other. And at times, you know, when it's too much for us to just set a boundary and, you know, create your own space so that you can process the emotional content that just arrived in this center. So that you can let it assimilate through the nervous system, through the cells, to your brain, and the part of your brain that registers this aspect of your awareness. This is a lens of perception of the feelings as in emotions. And all of our emotional content lies here. And as the breath continues all the way down through the chest into the belly and back up and out again, I'd like you to pay some specific attention to this heart center. How do we love in this time? How do we pause and recognize that we're in it together? What inside of our hearts can you feel or sense is here as we're all together present in this call from all over the world, just choosing to tune in via this wavelength by the wonderful invitation of Chris and Felina to take some time to reflect and to turn inward, away from the constant barrage of information that is constantly changing and keeps us in our heads and not in our hearts. And how is it for you in the last number of weeks that you have been practicing social distancing? How is your heart feeling and sensing right now? And what does your chest feel like on the inside? As your breath moves through this part of you, what is the quality of your heart saying at this moment? And just see if you can let arise whatever wants to arise from that heart's perspective. It probably is grateful that you're checking in, that you're paying attention here. That maybe it is feeling a little contracted, or maybe even numb. Or maybe you can feel and sense the gratitude as you're shifting your attention to your chest and simply being curious and seek some contact with yourself intimately through the placement of your attention and your breath. And what feelings arise? What emotions do you recognize? And what do they feel like in your chest cavity? What is the physical sensations that you encounter when the breath moves in and down through the chest cavity and then comes to a natural stop in the belly and then automatically on its own goes back up and out again through the chest cavity? And whatever arises, would you be willing to attempt to make space for whatever is arising, even if it doesn't feel so good right now? It's your heart that's talking to you. And is it okay, and are you willing to listen to whatever it is saying to you right now? This is how I feel. And just make space for that, simply by breathing around that sensation of that emotion, that energy that you're experiencing right now. And again, you may feel or you may encounter very little at all, or you may encounter an overwhelming barrage of feelings, or something in between. Whatever it is, if the overwhelm is coming, just simply find that the breath completes itself by breathing around and simply place your attention on that breath that is moving. This is one of the ways in which you can stay present to your own emotions without jumping into the fire, right? That's what we call a compassionate approach to a part of you that may be really craving, desiring close contact. And by all of us turning inside of ourselves right now to the state of our own heart, there is this wonderful opportunity to let our breath gently flow around it and touching the outskirts with that breath that we have, the breath that we receive. The breath that breathes itself. We do not have to guide or force or do the breathing. Thank God for creating us in this way, that this breath from the beginning and the first breath we take to the last breath, this breath is serving us at all times. Whether we are asleep or awake, whether we're in a good mood and happy or sad, whether we are upset or afraid or running for our lives or fighting, or we're in the most intricate philosophical discussion, or if we are in prayer and meditation, this breath flows and simply gives us life. This is our lifeline. And just notice as this breath flows, regardless of how we pay attention to it, that when we do place our attention on the breath and follow that breath, And the breath is conscious, becomes conscious. There is an enhancement of that breath. And we are now just sort of going on a little boat on the river of the breath. And again, it's something that is more of a state of non-doing than doing. It's simply joining the breath with our attention. And the more we place our attention on it fully, the more our brain will receive that we're alive. And the more the survival reflexes will calm down. And if we are full of fear of what might happen next, or what might happen at this moment, or what has happened in the past, when you shift your attention to the breath itself, you may experience a calm. And somehow, our brain settles. With the chosen conscious attention on the part of us that in this moment is fully alive. And this may as well be the only moment that we have. Because in the next moment, this moment is gone, it's in the past. And the next moment became the present moment. And the next moment lies in the future. So it's not here yet. So why not be here right now? And choose with our free will to place our attention on that trajectory through which the breath moves through us, through our being, giving us the energy and the oxygen we need. And just notice, where are you now? And what has changed? And where does that habit of attention come in and take us away from this lovely place of connection with ourselves for the moment? And when you notice that you have gone away because you have a habitual way in which your attention is going to take you away from this experience, in the moment you notice it, you can again simply choose to return or not. In this way, we have something to say about our state that arises from our attention simply joining the part of us that's already fully alive. That's already fully operating with a wholeness in our hearts. Where it knows that everyone and everybody is intrinsically connected. There's no such thing as separation. And notice when you shift your attention back to that place in your heart with the feelings that were there. And ask yourself again, can I allow these feelings? Can I simply observe them and allow them to move wherever they want to move? And notice that the energy rises of a feeling and comes to a peak, and then it falls back into yet another arising of another feeling. And you may notice that you have more access to that heart in this moment because you shifted your state. And just let's see if we can, during this time together, can keep this inner attention alive by staying aware of what's happening on the call and what's happening inside. And what part of our being needs us the most? Is it a fearful heart that we can't connect with another, or we can't get to our loved ones that may be suffering of coronavirus, or other families across the globe? And what happens if you go inside and just ask your heart, how does our heart feel about it? Is there, besides the fear, some other feelings? And what other feelings may be there? Is there grief? Sadness? Is there a certain amount of anger and upset about what's happening in the world and why this is happening? And what is the outer behavior that we are witnessing everywhere? Going to the store to get toilet paper? Is that what it is that we need or want? Or is this some kind of an expression of something else? And notice that our instinctual being is highly charged right now. And that survival brain in the backside of our heart, head, and also in the belly, below the belt, is operating unconsciously and is expressing itself through outer behavior. And when the somatic brain or the survival brain is operating, it has only one objective, and that is to stay alive at all costs. I need to get there before someone else can get there, so that I can get my roll of toilet paper. Where am I in the line to get some? Our hearts are frozen in fear. We cannot feel that love and that compassion in that moment because the instinctual brain, the instinctual impulse is so strong. That it takes over, even when we hide it behind you know, or underneath some rational thought that will justify our behavior. And this, I believe, is our greatest opportunity to wake up to how our brain is functioning. And can we become present to it so that we may have a choice in responding to this with conscious awareness rather than automatic reactive behavior? And pause and say, am I going to take as much toilet paper as I can, even though I know there's a long line behind me? And only a limited supply. Can I go back to my heart and feel the interconnectedness with everybody else? And not just pray for other people, but act like you're praying. Wherever you go, there you are. Understand the survival brain that we desperately need at this time to survive, but not at all costs and not because we are more important than the other. That requires conscious attention. And look at where you're now. What's happening inside of you as you're contemplating the way our brain is being organized? And know that that very highly active neocortex in the front, which is the mental aspect of our brain, is where we're thinking, where we have access to the memories of what happened in the past, where we imagine to be somewhere else where we aren't, because there's nowhere to go on this planet. This particular event has reached all the nooks and crannies on this planet. It's a great opportunity to wake up to a global consciousness that is necessary. And join hands despite cultural differences, political differences, socioeconomic differences. And start looking at what are we as a whole, as a species, going to learn from this? How can we wake up to more of ourselves so that we understand these behaviors and what they are for, and not mistaken one behavior, one aspect of your brain's behavior, for something altogether different, just because you don't recognize that this behavior is fueled by the serpent unconscious aspect of your survival brain? So see if you can slowly allow your attention to come back to yourself in your seat, your feet on the ground, the boundaries of your own skin, and allow your eyes to come on open. And I would like to open it up for some questions or just some comments or sharing what went on for you during this inner practice of three-centered awareness, the mental, emotional, and somatic brain, that is the survival brain, that all interacts and works together. And how can this be helpful for you to practice this? So, Felina, if you would like to see if there's any questions that may have been surfacing through this, you know, I'd like to open it up.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Mario, and for giving people an experience of connecting with those three centers. Mm-hmm. Often we're living so much in the head, we're neglecting the heart, or perhaps we're living very much in the body and we're neglecting other parts of ourselves. And so that experience of three-centered awareness is so critical for us. When we can get those lined up, we really can access those internal resources for freedom and compassion. And like you're saying, pray in our actions.
Yes.
Because we're aligned, right?
Exactly.
Yeah. So Amanda sent in some questions ahead of time. I wanted to see if we have a moment to address her one or two of her questions. Let's see here. She's asking about integration and the weaving of different threads. I wonder if you could just speak to this question related to the practice you took us through, and what does it mean for us to integrate?
That's a big question, and yet there could be a simple answer to that, and that is we cannot really do the integrating. The integration is what happens when we are fully aware and recognize all three centers and what these centers are communicating to us. So that requires an inner witness to be able to know what is happening in your thinking realm, what is happening in your emotional realm, and what's happening in your sensate realm, which is part of the belly center.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and so that kind of awareness, cultivating that capacity for awareness, how do we do that?
So the most important part is to know that if you follow the breath, it automatically takes you through all three centers. Even if you feel like your solar plexus or your diaphragm is really tight, there is still a trickle of that completion of the breath and the trajectory of the breath that happens. So you can take a felt sense inventory at all times by placing your attention on the breath and follow your breath in and down. That's number one. So then to learn how to read, you know, what it actually is saying depends on what lens of perception you place your attention, right? So the mental lens of perception, the language that we use is through thoughts and thinking and mental concepts and cognition, you know? So that is belonging to the neocortex, and that what is where most of us at this stage are being schooled to operate from. Doesn't matter what your lead center is, even though there may be belly-centered people, there are being more heart-centered people. Typically, we're in our societies, we are being asked, you know, to use our mental center in order to explain and to figure out what is going on and to think our way through it, right? Mm-hmm. So that has a particular quality of getting to learn about, you know, talking about and the meaning of what you're experiencing. But it won't tell you anything about the emotional content, because that's another lens of perception. That's the limbic system, and that's the emotional brain. And that emotional brain is here so that we can be imbued with emotional qualities that give us more the feeling of how we are drawn and attracted to being in contact with people, and how we at times may want to protect ourselves from getting our feelings hurt from other people. Mm-hmm. And that's the emotional content. Mm-hmm. Right? Mm-hmm. And then the belly content, which is a little bit less developed in our culture, not in the indigenous cultures. It was much more part of the indigenous, you know, way of life, and highly developed. So the instinctual intelligence that was developed by the indigenous people has been dumped down by the first world countries by over celebrating the neocortex and putting more emphasis on thinking, right? But the emotional intelligence and to feel and sense, so the felt sense of knowing where am I and what way is the wind blowing and how are the stars aligned and what is the landscape look feel like and what do I sense in the distance? Or when I step into a room and I can sense the energy in the room, that is part of a more sub and unconscious informative, you know, aspect of this lens of perception that we all work with, but not consciously.
Thank you. That's so helpful. Somebody here is asking, an anonymous attendee, she's saying, or he or she or they are asking, is it worth the effort? This is so hard for an Enneagram type 7. Any helpful hints? I'm finding this really difficult. Do other types have similar challenges? What would you say to that?
For a type 7, I would recommend go on a walk and do it. Don't sit still. You know, just do some movement, or even if you want to do a movement in the form of dance or yoga, just use this practice while you're doing your movement stuff. Mm-hmm. And that is much easier for the 7 in the beginning. Of course, at the end, since the 7 is really into being free and unlimited, you know, that is also really important that the 7 also learns how to sit still and do it. But don't start there.
Mm-hmm. And could you speak to the survival part of our brain and when we go into that survival mode, when we're out of alignment with our other centers, what is the impact? How might we understand the importance of actually doing, you know, the practice to get aligned?
Well, of course, this is very difficult in the somatic center because the word instincts already says it. Well, instincts need to operate instantaneously and with a speed that is way faster than thinking, right? Because if we have to think about saving ourselves when there is a car accident happening, you know, you would be not being very successful in surviving. So we have reflexes. And the survival reflexes are the defensive reflexes, as in fight, flight, and freeze, that kick in instantaneously. And then from there, we pop out into our neocortex or into some kind of an emotional reaction that may be fueled by one of these defensive reflexes. Yeah, there's a fight reflex, there's a flight reflex, and there's a freeze reflex. They are necessary for us to stay alive in our body long enough so that we can do our practice, so that we can live our lives and meet other people and study and do all the things we do, right? Mm. On the other hand, survival reflexes also constitute, you know, the positive reflexes that are nurturing, right? So there is a play reflex where we automatically as children, you know, when we are feeling relatively safe, you know, we'll want to explore the environment, the physical environment through play and bump up against things so that we get to know and understand what this physical world feels like and looks like. And then we have a curiosity reflex that after we've been really paralyzed with fear and somehow the danger, you know, moves away, we come back to curiosity and want to kind of be a little curious about what's going on, right? And then the other one that's here is the seeking reflex. So that's the one I was referring to from the heart center. You know, the seeking contact with other people and other things around us is another really important survival reflex. That's how our brain develops and gets informed about the environment that we live in. So these positive reflexes at the moment where we have a global threat to our health, you know, what are we highlighting? The 10% of the people that are dying, right? That is being stressed. And yes, that's not very wonderful. And it is important that we all do our best to minimize that with the behavior that will help to minimize the way that coronavirus can spread. At the same time, you know, the fight, flight, and freeze responses are operating in all of us right now. And they are contractions in our bodies that makes us feel like we have to protect ourselves from the world around us. And that's the isolation that's happening.
Yes, thank you for that. You know, that segues really well into this attendee's comment. And given that we're almost to the top of the hour, I think this might be a good way to transition to the close of our time together. But this just emphasizes a lot of what you're putting out there for us and highlighting the importance of the practice that you walked us through. Daniel says that he wants to thank you for this opportunity. It was his first time doing anything like this. He says, I've not experienced a lot of fear during this pandemic, but I have experienced anger as I've watched the way others have responded around me. And during this practice, I was able to access a deeper compassion for people, realizing that many who are responding in fear are operating from their survival brain, also recognizing there is no guidebook for this. This practice has also caused me to get curious about where this anger is coming from within me. And I think it could be potentially rooted in a deep sadness. As an Enneagram 2, I wonder if I feel sad for all who are feeling fear out of control and there's nothing that can be done to help them.
Yeah,
I mean, it's
a pretty good analysis.
Yeah.
Don't forget, you know, the anger, especially in the heart types with the underlying sadness, is still coming from the fear of losing the contact with the other. So that is, there is still something to know about anger being a fight reflex that is born out of, you know, the need to survive for all of us and to come inside. And what about my own need to survive for the two? Where are my own needs in this? And can I apply that anger towards, you know, the deeper compassion for my own needs that I may have at this time.
Thank you, Marion, so much for taking time out of your schedule to be with all of us today and to guide us through this three-centered awareness. I know that that those who've attended will be able to continue to return to that that practice that you've taught them today and for your insight and your wisdom. For the sake of time, I want to return this over to Chris to give us a few outros and bring our time together to a close.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks so much, Marion. Seriously, what a gift. And I think this playback will be such a gift for folks in terms of being able to return to this practice. Thank you, everybody, for joining. I'll make this really quick here. I want to give you a few resources here so that you can keep up with what you just been introduced to. And so let's start with Marion's website here. And hopefully this is her website. Here at the top, you can learn more about her services, the Somatic Enneagram, Somatic Intelligence. And also there's a place here to contact with her. If you haven't actually checked out her Enneagram Makers podcast that her and I launched or released a week ago tomorrow, you can do that and find that anywhere that you listen to podcasts. And Marian, the people have loved this. In just 6 days, there's been more than 11,500 downloads of this show. So if you haven't heard it, please check it out. And then some of you who track with Gravity know that she's going to be facilitating, God willing, and if we can all get together in July, and who knows, if not, we'll figure out a way to bring this online. But she'll be introducing or facilitating our summer enlightening retreat. Those are a few quick ways to be able to get in touch with her and to figure out what she's up to. Those are a few quick ways to sort of stay connected. Just to remind you one more time, and hopefully this screen share also works, I want to let you know that for these wellness webinars, that's probably not the page that we're looking for. On Mondays, again, we'll be bringing experts, wellness and health experts here to sort of help you sort of find and guide your way through some of these uncertainties. On Wednesdays, these will be guided spiritual practice and meditations. And then on Fridays will be kid contemplations. You can find these things on the Gravity website so that you can find the playbacks and a little bit about the shows. All the show notes will be here on the website as well as on the embedded video playbacks. And the kids contemplation Fridays are just turning out to be great. This week will be Morgan Harper Nichols, who will be guiding children and the inner child in us through a sort of art practice. And then Anais Salazar, 2 weeks now, will help folks with their children who are trying to figure out how to be a stay-at-home tutor while your children are needing support with their education. We love it that you're a part of this. We love it that we're creating a kind of virtual community online to support each other. We've seen a lot of you connecting over here in the chat sidebar. And so as we turn off our cameras and we mute this and end the show, we'll leave this chat here open just for 4 or 5 minutes for some of you to connect and to take these conversations offline if you'd like. Really so thankful for you all, so thankful for your presence and so thankful for you being who you are in the world. Continue to say yes to the beautiful parts of yourself. Continue to say yes to compassion and caring for yourself. And continue to be kind with yourself, because it's okay to not be okay. It's okay to be afraid. It's okay to feel the sadness. But welcome it, listen to it, and let it guide us into the new we that the new normal is going to require for us. And so be kind to yourself and love yourself. Thank you for being part of this.